Today, I have in my kitchen a friend of mine. Her name is Jen Nurse, who is a culinary teacher here in San Francisco. Welcome to my kitchen.
Thank you, Lorraine.
Okay, here we go.
All right, it's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me. And today we're gonna make a simple fruit torte. All right, so the first thing we want to do is prepare our pan. So I just want to grease it all over the place. And then I will just add a small amount of flour to the pan. I'm not going to measure it or anything. I'm just going to scoop it right on it. And then I simply tap the pan to move the flour around. Then tap it to get off the excess and right back into the bin. And as you can see, you end up with a really thin, nice coating.
Yeah, perfect.
And yeah, that was really simple, right? Yeah. One thing I find in my cooking classes is that many students have some confusion or actually don't know that there are different types of measuring cups for dry versus wet ingredients.
Okay.
In general, these hard-sided cups that look like this are for dry ingredients. And this type of cup, a Pyrex or something that's glass or often plastic that has the handle on it and a pouring spout, is for liquids. And does it matter? Actually, yes, it does matter.
Yes.
Cup of flour to start. And then I take something flat and I just, without pressing it down, I just give it a simple swipe across the top. You know, I've got my grandmother's old-fashioned sifter at home, mm-hmm. and for anyone who has a sifter with the squeeze handle, of course you can use one of those. That's a cup of flour right into the sieve. And with that, I'm going to add a teaspoon of baking powder. So again, I'm going to level it off, and this container happens to have a nice handy little thing for doing that. And right in it goes with the flour. I've got a half teaspoon of salt here, and I'm going to add it. Okay. And I, in my view, it's mandatory in the recipe. And as you can see, now I'm just sifting these together into a bowl. So now we're done with this, and I'll set this aside, and we're going to move on to our wet ingredients. All right, so this recipe calls for 4 ounces of butter, or half a cup, which is an American cube of butter, stick of butter. So in it goes. So I'm going to go ahead and zest this lemon directly into my butter and sugar mixture. This recipe calls for 3/4 cup of sugar, similar to what I did before, and then level it off with something nice and flat, and in the bowl it goes. If you don't have a KitchenAid or a standing mixer at home, which many home cooks don't, you can absolutely mix this recipe with a hand mixer. And as a guideline, mm-hmm. I usually tell people to increase the mixing time about 50% with a hand mixer. I'm gonna start to cream this. This is called creaming. And that looks like a good creaming speed to me, and that's on speed 6. Again, your mixer at home might be quite different. You'll have to be the judge. So take a look at what's happening in here.
Oh, yeah.
See, it's all incorporated
yes.
at this point.
It's not clumpy anymore.
Now, one thing that most bakers I know really dread, and I dread it too, but I make myself do it anyway, is we have to scrape the bowl from time to time. If you don't scrape, you end up with unevenly mixed ingredients, and I also like to scrape the paddle. And then I'll just mix it again, back up on 6. This thing goes all the way to 10, which is, you know, great. So I will, in fact, grab my eggs, which are now nice and at a room temperature. Even after hundreds and hundreds of wedding cakes and, you know, professional cakes mm-hmm. that I've baked for people, I still crack my eggs into a separate bowl before I add them to my batter. The reason is, well, you never know when you're gonna get a bad egg. So second egg is gonna go in. With the mixer running, I'm gonna go ahead and have you just pour in one. And then, here's another thing I see a lot with beginning bakers that they don't know. You should wait for that first egg to fully incorporate with your butter sugar mixer before you dump in that second egg. Depending on the temperature, you know, if it's a really cold day and your kitchen's a little cooler, or if it's a really warm day right. and things are meltier, it might take longer or shorter for that to incorporate. So So one more scrape. I know you just have to really be patient. Be disciplined about it. Make yourself do it. So we've got our lemon zest, our sugar, and our butter creamed in here, and now we've added our eggs.
Correct.
The next thing I'm going to add is a little vanilla. It calls for a half teaspoon. So a thing to know about almond extract, again, you want to use the good stuff, is that a little goes a long way. So I don't have a super small measuring spoon handy, but I'm definitely not going to use a full half teaspoon. I'm just going to do a few drops like that.
Almost a quarter, not even quite. Yeah.
Okay, so I'll give that just a very quick mix to stir it in. The last thing we'll do is, do you want to do this part?
Sure.
Is gradually add in the dry ingredients to the wet. I'm going to turn this on a fairly low speed, and you can go ahead and add it pretty, not too slowly. You don't want to overmix, because once you add liquid to the flour and you start to mix it, you are activating the gluten. If you're making bread, that's a good thing. That's why we need bread to work the gluten and make it rubbery and stretchy. Yes. It gives us that gorgeous chewy bread, right? In a cake, not so much. So I actually often, at the end of a cake mixing process, I like to do the last couple turns by hand. This ensures that you're not over mixing. This recipe actually is quite non-specific in the size of pan that it calls for, but it says 8, 9, or 10 inches across.
So it's your choice.
And so, yes. So this guy is just barely shy of 10 inches, I would say, or I think we would call this a 10-inch pan. So this is the largest size. And what I've found with this is that when we add our fruit, which we're going to do in a little bit, the bigger the pan, the more the fruit will show in the end after you bake it. So it's just your preference. Whatever size pan you own is going to be perfectly fine. And you'll see this, it's going to look quite shallow in here, the batter, and that's okay. You're just going to spread it around as evenly as you can, being patient. So it's in the pan. Now we're going to cut our fruit.
Okay.
Now you can see that we're cutting up the fruit to place on top of the cake. And you don't want to wait too long once you get the batter in the pan. So as I mentioned, we've got these beautiful plums. And I find the easiest way to cut them apart is to, they kind of have this natural line, as stone fruits tend to do. And I just turn the fruit around in my hand along that line. And then you can just kind of unscrew it. Now you'll see these plums are slightly overripe. And because of that, the pits aren't coming out clean. Mm-hmm. And this could happen to you at home also. So I just want to show you that it's not a loss. I would just make sure and salvage the fruit that's around there. And then I just use a little paring knife to get under the other side of the pit carefully. And I'm just sawing around to remove that other half.
Right.
And, you know, you may think, well, that looks kind of messy. But trust me, once it's in the pan, it's going to be just fine. And then I'm just cutting this into simple wedges. I always go across from each other and then try to fit in as much as possible. I think I'll just cut this one into chunks, and we'll just put the chunks here kind of in the middle. Just little last pieces. We don't want to waste any. And then the recipe calls for squeezing a couple teaspoons of lemon juice over the cake, and I love to do that. So I'm just going to squeeze this casually again all over the top of this. And I'm guessing that's about 2 teaspoons. This is quite a juicy lemon, so I would say less than half of most lemons will be enough. You have this beautiful shaker, so I'm going to go ahead and just use it until it sort of looks right to me. And if you're not a cinnamon fan, just omit the cinnamon. I brought over some turbinado sugar.
Yeah, I love that, because I have that as well.
Which is nice and big and grainy and crunchy, and it'll give us a little bit of crunch on the top, which I love. And again, I'm not going to measure this. I'm just going to sprinkle all over the surface. Our oven is at 350 degrees, and I find that this guy will bake anywhere between 45 and 60 minutes. It's kind of a long bake. The fruit is quite dense, obviously. Yeah,
look how beautiful
exactly.
That is.
There you go. Yes. So in it goes. Although, like I said, you know, we're going to lose some of that pattern, but that's okay. Our cake smells really good. So we're gonna test and see if it's ready.
Okay.
I have a nice dry towel in my hand if you don't have an oven mitt handy. So you'll see the top got nice and golden. And I find that I don't need to bake this cake on convection normally. So I'm gonna insert a tester in here into one of the dough parts. So I like to stick it in kind of at an angle and move it around a little bit. And then you see if it comes out wet or dry. Again, we baked it in the 10-inch pan today. This is a brand new one. And I baked one for us yesterday so that you could see the difference.
Oh, that's good.
And I'll just show you. So this is a 9-inch pan, and you can see how much more the fruit sank. And that happened because the batter was deeper.
Right.
So this is why we bake it in a springform pan. I take a small knife, and I'm always pressing against the pan and not against the cake. And I just slide it all the way around, pressing always against the pan. Then you can undo the clip on your springform pan. And you should gently ease it open to make sure nothing's stuck to the sides too much. And you can see it release. So now I feel comfortable lifting it up.
Perfect.
Right?
Oh my God, look how beautiful that is.
Okay. It's a little beauty. I set it right on a nice pretty plate.
Oh, I can't wait to eat it.
I know, me too.
It's so gorgeous no matter what. Thank you so much. I love the tricks that you taught me.
Oh, I'm glad.
I'm gonna be baking this for a while for all my friends because it's visually and I'm sure it's gonna taste delicious.
I hope you will.
Thank you, Jen.
You're welcome.
My friend.
My friend.